Good morning.
Good morning. Bless the Lord.
I was going to say, I don't know what to say because I feel like we're missing a lot of our church this morning. But here's what I'll say is I miss them and I love them.
Amen.
And so if you know somebody's missing this morning and you got their phone number, do me a favor, call them up. Check in on them and just let them know that you love them. That's all you're doing. Just let them know that you love them. They might be dealing with something this morning that they need to hear from one of us telling them that we love them and that God's not forgot them. So we're going to stand up and we're going to open up in prayer. That'll be all right.
Amen.
Please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we're grateful to have this place to worship this morning, God. God, we're grateful for all of us that you've brought here this morning, God. God, we pray, Lord, that you'd protect them that's not here with us this morning worshiping God. And God, those that are viewing from live stream in any other way, God, we ask you, Lord, that your word would go out and penetrate their hearts this morning. God, we ask you, Lord, that your word would touch our hearts, God. We ask you, Lord, to help each and every one of us, God, to open up our heart, Lord, that you might speak to us this morning. We ask you, God, that you would anoint the message this morning, God, that we might feel your presence. God, without you, Lord, I said it earlier this morning, I would cry, God. God, because, Lord, I need you. And, God, the more I get to know you, the more I lean on you for everything, God. And, God, I ask you, Lord, to continue to be there for your church and continue to strengthen us to do your will. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Jesus.
Say Guitar. Josh and the guitar. There are many things that all of us face. Many things that perplex us, come against us. Song I sang just recently, and I just don't think it's the kind of song you want to forget. It's How Great Thou Art. You can put it up here if you could. And because he truly is. It's a great song because of the fact that it talks about, of all the things that come against us, we need to understand that God is greater than the situation. is greater than the things that we face. And sometimes when the enemy comes and says, look what I've done, you can look at him and say, but my God is greater still. Greater still, and I still am in his hands, so I'm not going to bend or bow to you. How great thou art. Let's sing together. Stand to your feet for just a moment. Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the scarce can take it in. Man on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul. My soul. the Lord.
Good morning again, all of you. We're going to be reading in the book of Jude, chapter 1, verse 14 through 25. In the book of Jude, verse 14, it reads, "And Enoch also, the servant from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are the murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lust.
Amen.
And their mouth speaketh great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. But, beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time, who should walk after their own ungodly lust. These be they who separate themselves sensual, having not the Spirit. But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And of some having compassion, making a difference. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotting by the flesh. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, and to present your faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty,
hallelujah,
dominion.
Praise. Hallelujah. All glory. Hallelujah.
Power.
Oh, hallelujah.
Sorry, I can't see it that well, but I can feel it.
Amen. Come on, Deacon.
Both now and ever. Amen.
Yes. Amen. Praise the Lord.
For some time, I've been preaching to you that we're on the verge of something very big.
Amen.
And I believe in revival.
Amen.
To have a revival, you need a revelation.
Yep.
Oh. Amen.
Amen.
And once you get the revelation, you need a revolution.
Hallelujah.
And for some time, I've been preaching about the fact that God is waiting for us. He wants to bless.
Yeah.
And most everyone that I talk with feels the same way. They believe that God is going to do something grand. It's almost as if time itself is pregnant and ready to give birth to the greatest move of God's Spirit on these latter days. And you say, Pastor, is there going to be a great revival that sweeps the world? I can't tell you that. The only thing that I do know is the Bible does say that in the latter days God will pour out his Spirit upon all flesh. So if your flesh hadn't had any, you need to get under the spout where the glory comes out.
Yes. Amen.
You see, I believe in the greatest encounter of God's Spirit the world has ever known is going to hit the latter church. And the reason I believe that is because oftentimes people say that, you know, the early church was grand and they went to the lions, they were crucified, and they would not bend or bow because they loved the Lord with all their heart. I believe the latter church going out of here, the church that witnesses to the fact that the last part of this world will be just as strong as the early church was. I believe that. I believe that with all of my heart that it's only a matter of time before things begin to break wide open with God.
Amen.
And begin to saturate us completely with the Spirit and experience of truly or a true Holy Ghost revival. And we need that today in the day that we're living in. I do have one major concern that I want to talk to you about, and that is, are we prepared this morning to receive it? I mean, God wants to do it. He already told us in His Word that He wants to pour out His Spirit, but are you ready to receive it? Sometimes, you know, when God wants to do something in the church, we're afraid of our neighbor who'll look at us and say, did you see them with their hand up there making all that noise right in the house of God? Well, the thing is, you need to get over the people that are around you and say, Lord, I've come into your house to be blessed by your presence. I have come into your house, Lord God, to worship you because you spoke my name when I needed you the most, and then you wrote my name down in the glorious book of life. I'm not over that, God, so I've come into your house to say, glory, glory, glory. Our God is worthy of praise. He is worthy of acclamation. Our God is high and lifted up, and His people need to know that God still is high and lifted up. Amen, amen, and amen again. I'll throw in an extra and a praise the Lord and a glory to God right in the middle of it.
Amen.
The Bible declares to us many truths, but one truth is reiterated over and over again, and that is the truth of preparation precedes blessing. Noah prepared for 100 years, 120 years, to receive the blessing of salvation for him and his family. That's a long time, amen? And then some of you are thinking, I might as well just give up. I prayed for my child already almost 6 months. He was waiting 120 years. Jeremiah preached for 42 years and didn't get one single solitary convert. Well, I've got him beat at least by one. I believe you ought to be prepared for what God's going to do. I come into His house. I'm anticipating that God's going to... Some of you already should have got a blessing because you got up this morning, looked at the snow, and said, I'm still going to go.
Yep.
Amen. Amen.
Some people got up this morning and said, you've got to be kidding me. That looks totally like winter. The Shunammite woman prepared a place for the man of God. Now, I'll tell you what, I could preach here a long time.
Amen.
Because the Shunammite woman said, you know what? I am going to prepare a place for the man of God because he might be coming by today. And somebody said, well, that's just our pastor. No, I'm talking about the man of God. I'm talking about the one that God can give the word to, and the word has power. I may not have power, but the word of God will go out and it will never come back void. So you ought to prepare yourself for the man of God today. Lord, here I am in your house. I want you to bless me, God. I want to feel your presence around me. I want to know, God, that you're speaking to me, and God is speaking to you. He wants you to know this world with all of its difficulty is not greater than His Word.
Amen.
So she prepared for a place. She said, when the man of God comes by, I want you to build a little place right here on my house so that he don't have to go anywhere else. He can stay right here in my house. I want the man of God in my house. I want the man of God's word in my house. I may need him someday. I may need the word someday. Well, here his the Shunammite woman daughter or son died, and she said to the man of God, listen, the blessing that was given to me is now in jeopardy, and I'm scared, and what are you going to do about it? He said, I'm on my way. And he got there, and the Bible said he laid himself over the child and breathed life into the child, and the child recovered. If you prepare for God to be in your house, you may need him someday. And when you call out, God says, here I come, skipping across the mountains down into the valley to touch you.
Amen.
Time and time again throughout God's awesome word, we find the pattern of preparation preceding blessing. I'm prepared to get a blessing. I come here to get a blessing. I can't hardly do it because there's only half our church here.
Let me tell you something. When half the church is here, you've got to praise for the whole church. You know, you've got to make up the difference. I never said nothing about the offering. Just praise. Amen. Listen, I'm sure you've already asked yourself the question, how do we even begin to prepare to receive the greatest harvest that we have ever seen in these latter days? Where do we start? I will tell you the best place to start is letting the hunger for things of God begin to consume you. Jesus himself said, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Hunger for God. I have a hunger for God. Amen. I truly have a hunger for God. I listen sometimes, and I think Ed told me this morning he ain't going to listen to the news anymore for a long time. I listen to the news, and I understand why he said even more, because I was listening. It's very depressing, them newscasters. Because first of all, they haven't found anything good about America for so long, it's pathetic. But let me just go on. I don't want to get stuck there, because I will get stuck there. I know where church is really all about him. So I'm going to leave them fellas on the outside, amen, and just bring Jesus in here. It is all about worship. It is all about his presence. It's not about us or our need for things. It's all about him. As far as I can tell, hunger is the only thing that has the ability to predetermine how much God you're going to get. Amen. I mean, have you ever noticed that when you're really hungry, you sit down, you start eating everything that's there, right? I mean, you just start from one end of the table to the other until finally you say, oh, and I got to tell you, we could have said it a lot earlier, but finally we say, oh, that hit the spot. Truly, not only did it hit the spot, but in most of our cases, it covered the spot and didn't leave another spot. Maybe that's just me. I like to eat. Especially hillbilly food. Amen. Hillbilly food is hard to describe to some of you people from Central Ohio.
Amen.
Did any of you just ever eat green beans that are cooked by somebody in Central Ohio? I remember people coming over to my house, and they said, what is this? I said, it's green beans. Said, what did you season them with? I said, I told a little bacon grease. Little side meat on cake. Well, I said, but why did they taste like this? I said, well, you have to cook them. Well, we cook our beans. We get them out of the can, put them on the stove. In about 15, 20 minutes, they're ready. Our beans, we get them out of the can that we can, and we put them in stove, and we cook them for 3 hours and 45 minutes. And everybody says, what in the world? Why would you cook beans that long? You taste hillbilly beans, and you understand why it took us that long to cook them. Something great like that takes a little time. Amen? Amen. Now, I got to tell you, I make dumplings like my mother. Chicken and dumplings, green beans, cornbread, a little fried chicken. Y'all wanting to leave right now, aren't you? That's what I'm thinking. Listen, most of the time, though, when you're hungry, and you know the only thing that's going to satisfy it is to eat. Amen. Well, you know what? God said, I want you to hunger and thirst after righteousness. The thing is, church really is all about him. Amen. And how hungry are you really is the question. I remember the story of a hungry woman who she began to ask God for divine intervention. She began to ask God for divine. She had a physical hunger, and she had no way to provide for herself. And she had two sons. And so the prophet told the widow to collect emptiness. Go and find everything that you can find that is empty, and I'll bless it. If you give God your emptiness, I believe God will bless it. Amen. He said to the woman, he says, you go to every one of your neighbors and you get every pot and pan you can find that is empty, and you bring it here with nothing in it. I don't want nothing else in it. I want to fill it with me. And then that woman brought all that emptiness. His exact words were, go borrow the vessels abroad of thy neighbors, even empty vessels, but borrow not a few. Isn't that beautiful the way he said? Don't you get just a few of them. He said, get every one that you can find. How many of you are really hungry for God? You got to bring the whole vessel, all the vessel, and say, God, I'm empty. I want you to fill me up. That meant borrow a lot of pots and pans. And go get as many empty containers as you can and get your hands on and collect all the emptiness that you know how to get. And this desperate widow and mother had no idea that the volume of her collected emptiness would determine her future. Are you willing to do what God has you to do? Sometimes doing what God has you to do seems a little far-fetched, amen? I got to tell you something. I remember when we started to build this church, and somebody told me, they said, well, you know, you're making the sanctuary awfully large. I said, yes, but eventually God's going to fill it.
That's right.
Amen.
And then before we got this field, we made that gymnasium, and they said, you know, I don't understand why in the world that you did something like that, because here we are out in the middle of nowhere, and where do you expect? Let me tell you something. I believe with all of my heart that a church alive is worth the driving. You ought to come. Amen. You ought to come, because if you're empty, if you're seeking God, you may not find it down the street where you go in and everybody's afraid to preach the gospel because of the fact that they might offend somebody, or they'll change the gospel and say, that's not what God meant. It was just a little bit of stuff that he put in there for the culture. But I want you to know, my God said, I change not. I am the same today. I do not change. What I said in the beginning is what I stand for now. And when the world is on fire, the word of God will stand, and I'll step out on the word of God, and I will stand too. Glory to God. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Listen, when she started collecting the pots and pans, she didn't know how it was going to end out. All she knew was to obey God's command. She didn't realize that her cumulative emptiness would literally determine the measure of her miraculous filling. Amen. That is simply how God works, by the way. Some of us are determined to present our fullness for God to fill. Listen, if you can't get some empty, God can't put anything in there. And I'll give you an example of this. Have you ever had a desire to have a cold Pepsi? Or Coke for some of you. Have you? Those of you have ever had a desire for one of those things with ice in it, raise your hand. Okay. Well, that's pretty good. And the rest of you do not drink Pepsi or Coke whatsoever, apparently. And that's all right, too. But here's the thing. Let's say that I really wanted a cold glass of Pepsi Cola. Well, in my case, it would be Diet Coke. And I had a full glass of water. And the new Diet Coke. And I'm going to pour my Diet Coke in that full glass of water. What do you think is going to happen? It's going to spill over, right? And so I ain't going to be able to get very much of it if I keep pouring, because if it was full, all I can do is maybe put a little drizzle in there and it's done. It starts pulling over. But let's say I do get a lot of that Coke in there, and I mix it up really good with the water. And then I said, I can't wait to take this Diet Coke and drink it, watered down like nobody's business. I'm going to tell you something. I will never preach you a gospel that's been watered down. I will always give you something that's fresh off the tap. Amen? It'll always be ready. But you need to get rid of the dross that you already got in the cup and say, God, here's my cup. I lift it up. Fill it up, God. Fill it up with your presence. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Now, if you don't pour out the water, it's kind of nasty. I'm going to tell you that right now. Matter of fact, you know I'm right, because how many of you have left your Coke in there until the ice melted? And then for sport, you didn't want to get up, you lazy thing. So you drank what was in there and did this. And that's not the first time you've done it. You've probably done it 20, 30 times. Let the ice melt and it dilutes what you're drinking, and you make that face. And the next time you have an opportunity, either one or two things. Either you're dumber than a bucket of rocks kicked over, or you like making that face. One of the two. But I think it might be good on occasion to just chew the ice cubes until they're gone and go get a brand new set of stuff. Amen?
Amen.
Some of you are looking at me like that's the worst example you've ever heard. It might be. So I suggest, so that you don't believe that, or if you think that I've given you a bad example, you go home and you pour yourself half a glass of water and half a glass of Pepsi and have at it. I told one fellow one time, I think it was Davis's boy, Dwayne Davis, you all know him, comes here whenever he can. He lives up in, I don't know where he lives, Lorain maybe, Cleveland, some suburb up in that area. He comes here whenever he can. I was at his house, and I was teaching on something, I forget what it was, and I mentioned milk and honey. And his boy said, I've never had that. I said, oh, well, you got to try it. So he went and got himself a glass of milk, and he poured a glob of honey in it, mixed it around, and drank it. And he said, Pastor, this is awful. God said he'd take us to a land of milk and honey. He didn't tell you, I want you to go and mix it.
Praise the Lord.
I mean, if you take a good drink, you're not going to taste that ice cold Pepsi Cola. You're going to taste the watered down version. And today, people have gotten so used to the watered down version, they no longer know what the real thing is.
Amen.
Nobody gets up and says there is a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. You bring up hell with its fire and its awfulness, people won't come back to the church. But I would rather tell you that hell was not made for you. It was made for the devil and his angels. But the children of God can stand on the right side of the judgment seat with the Lord of God on their side, saying, these are mine, in whom I'm well pleased. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. You know, we must become empty sometimes in order to get filled. It's time to prepare ourselves for the thing that God wants to give us, and that is revival. I believe God wants to have a revival in our church. Now, I've heard about other revivals in other places. Some of them go 2-3 weeks anymore. Some of them down, what was the one down in North Carolina, has went 6 months or something like that, was it? About
Amen.
That? About 6 months down in North Carolina. I remember one revival that I was supposed to preach in. When I got there, they said, one of the members said, we really don't think that you're the one that God has sent for this revival. And that's a hard way to start a revival. I got to tell you that right now. And I said, oh. They said, I think you're here because you know the pastor. I said, oh. So I began to preach revival that week, preaching as hard as I could preach. And I preached it that week. I preached everything that I had. And then just for sport, I said, I ain't going home. We'll preach the next week just as hard as I've done it on this week. And after 3 weeks of revival and 58 people that had given their heart to the Lord, they decided maybe, just maybe, I was the guy that had the Word of God at that particular instance in time. By the way, the Word of God doesn't have to worry about the deliverer. It is in the delivery, and the Word of God is what you need. Let me tell you, there is a diverse difference between the way I preach and the way that Bob preached. But listen to what he preaches. Listen to the Word. You'll find out that the Word of God has enough power always to bless your heart, to bless your soul, to make you stand up and say, whoopee, God is still on the throne. The Lord is still the Lord. And the Holy Ghost of God is not dependent on anybody but me. I have emptied myself. Oh, God, send down the blessing and let it come. Amen.
Amen.
It's all about, it's time to prepare ourselves for the thing that God wants to give us. It's all about how hungry you are. The things of the world or the things of God. Which one do you want? Which one of those things do you want? The things of the world, the things of God. We need a desperate, intense hunger to overtake us. I want to get closer to God. And this year, I got to tell you, we talked about that last week, and I want to tell you this again. We need to do everything that we can this year to move closer to God than we've ever been before. I believe with all of my heart that we're going to be challenged this year like nobody. We need a desperate, intense hunger to overtake us. We must be prepared to begin a revolution of spirituality, because I believe the church is still strong enough to have revival. Believe it? Believe it? Believe it? I hope you do. I believe the church is still strong enough with everything that's happening. And by the way, I know sometimes that I have said, and Ed and I talked about that this morning, but I have said that I have run a lot of people off. And that is probably the truth, because I always preach the truth. But I also believe with all of my heart that there is the sound of footsteps of those that want to come this way just to hear the Word of God again. They want to hear what God has to say. They want to go into a church where it's still all right to raise your hands and say praise the Lord. They want to go into a place where it is common for the Spirit of God to come down and touch men and women, boys and girls. They want to go into a place where it's still heard about that God is on the throne, They want to be able to say, I can stand even in the world that I'm at because I am surrounded by the power and the presence of God. This morning, I got up and I put on the armor of God. I found out that my feet were shod with the preparation of the gospel. I found out that I've got a breastplate on that the devil can't get through. And every time he comes, I slip on the helmet of salvation. And he says, I'll have to pass him by. I can't get to him. He's too well equipped. And then when it looks like he comes at my family, off my side, I pull the sword. And I say, thus saith the Lord God Almighty. And here is where we stand.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. Amen.
A divine discontent is stirring down in the inside of me to preach the word of God to you like I never have before. I'm reminded of the words of Isaiah. Cry aloud and spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet and show my people their transgression. It's time for a revolution in our thinking. Amen? Amen. Too long the enemy has had the upper hand. It's time for you and I to stand at the doors, every door in this place, and say this house is the house of God, and the devil will not come here, for every door is saturated by prayer. Listen, it's time for the elders to howl and weep from the porch to the altar and say, this be the house of God.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Too long my lost family and friends have been bound by spirits of darkness and oppression. And America today is rolling in luxury and prosperity as never before. But in God's eyes, her immorality is revolting and repulsive.
Amen.
Now, I want you to understand, I'm not talking about a Republican or a Democrat right now, because I'm neither one, so don't y'all get mad at me. If you're a Democrat, you can still hold your head up. And if you're a Republican, you can hold your head up. Because I ain't talking about any one of you. I'm talking about Washington, D.C., the cesspool of America.
Amen.
Totally different. Although there are some Democrats and Republicans in both of them. But our president got on the thing, and he said one thing, and then the other people wanted to refute him immediately, and they stood up. I tell you what, I heard one commentator said it looked like the old painting, you know, where the farmer's got a pitchfork and the woman beside him's got that glassy